Welcome back to another video. Today I'm going to talk about the mystery of Karel Novak, an unidentified man who was found in Czechoslovakia in the 1950s, and all the ambiguities surrounding his life. The investigative authorities were sure that he was a foreign spy, but he adamantly maintained his innocence for over 30 years. Let's get right into the story. On June 24th of 1955, guards monitoring the Slovak-Polish border stumbled upon a man who was wandering around a wooded area. They tried calling out to him, but he showed no response. When they approached him, the frightened man couldn't identify himself, and he made gestures that indicated that he was both deaf and mute. He didn't have any forms of ID on him, and the bag that he was carrying didn't contain anything that they could use to identify him. The only things in it were a razor for shaving, a knife, a napkin, and Polish salami and bread. The guards were suspicious of his behavior and lack of identifying documents. They thought that he was Polish and attempting to illegally cross the border. As per the protocol, he was taken to a nearby town to be questioned by the immigration police there. He communicated with the police through writing, and did so in both German and Slovak. The man claimed that he could not speak or hear, and that he was suffering from amnesia, which made him lose most of his memories. He said that the only aspects of his life that he could remember were that he was born in Czechoslovakia in 1934, that he'd been deaf and mute since he was born, and that his name was Karel Novak. For reference, this name is like the Czechoslovakian version of John Smith. Eventually, he added quite a bit more to this story. According to Karel, around 1941 or 1942, when the Nazis occupied Czechoslovakia, they took him and his parents to Austria. He said that his family was killed by the Gestapo while he was transported to Graz, Austria to attend a school for the deaf and mute. He attended this institution for 2 years, and it was the only time he received any formal education. Karel said that this school was also where he found out his name, birthday, and nationality for the first time, as well as where he learned German. He claimed that he left Austria in 1947 when authorities found out that he was Czechoslovakian and they transported him back. He met someone named František Tomíček, who was also deaf and mute, at a train station, and the two started to work at restaurants together. At this point, Karel started to teach himself Czech and Slovak. Eventually, he left this area and began wandering around the country. To support himself, he would pick mushrooms and sell them in the summer, and he would get a casual job in a restaurant in the winter where he'd be compensated with food and an apartment to live in. In January of 1955, Karel ended up in Ostrava, where he was sleeping in a train station. At this point, his main source of income was repairing skis for tourists in the mountains. A few days before he was arrested, he'd been on his way from Ostrava to the mountains when he got lost and ended up by the border. The police were almost certain that he was lying about his identity. There were a lot of inconsistencies with his story. For one, he displayed a high level of intelligence despite only claiming to receive less than 5 years of education. He was also extremely fluent in Czech, Slovak, and German, and had mastered the grammar rules, which is very difficult for someone who can't speak or hear. There's also the fact that no one could back up any of the parts of his story. For example, when the authorities tried asking people who were involved with the school he claimed to attend in Austria, or people who lived near the Ostrava train station, no one recognized him or remembered seeing him. The authorities were certain that he was a spy and warranted further investigation. They also didn't think that he was actually deaf, but doctors who examined him at the time believed that he was probably telling the truth about this. However, they did think something was off, in particular with Karel's tongue placement in relation to his palate, which was indicative of someone who could speak. During the examination, Karel could make inarticulate noises, but he couldn't form any words. The doctor couldn't explain how he was able to communicate with flawless written grammar in more than one language while being mute and deaf. His deafness was also backed up by a prisoner who was in close proximity to Karel when he was detained in a cell for observation. The man said that Karel definitely could neither hear nor speak, and he also said that he displayed signs of strange behavior. In October, a few months after he was initially arrested and detained, Karel's case was taken over by the Investigation Department of the Regional Administration of the Ministry of the Interior in Prague. He was transferred over, still in custody. The search for who exactly Karel Novak was got a lot more intense from here on. Officers began searching across the nation for anyone who could positively identify him. A month later, they ended up finding one person who claimed to know Karel. Her name was Františka Bielakova, and she too was deaf and mute. She said that they went to school together from 1942 to 1944 at the Institute for the Deaf and Dumb in Kromnica, Slovakia. According to her, Karel was actually German, and he was deported back to his home country in 1944. The the authorities ended up determining that Frontischka's claims were entirely unsubstantiated, and they dropped this lead. In the pursuit of more leads, authorities started to hone in on returnees, meaning people living in refugee camps after the war. Here they actually found two people who claimed that they knew Karel. The first witness is a man named Kamil Chervenka. He said that he met a man who met Karel's description in a refugee camp near Nuremberg between the years of 1951 and 1954. Kamil said that the man that he believed was Karel spoke Czech with an accent. He was also fluent in English, so Kamil said that he thought he was an interpreter, likely for the US government seeing as the camp was near their counterintelligence office. Another refugee who claimed to recognize Karel was named Ernest Solchansky. After seeing a photograph of Karel, he said that he met him at a refugee camp in Wels, Austria around 1952. Ernest said that Karel had a bandage around his arms because they were severely burned. While Karel denied that this was true, authorities did find that he had forearm scars. Karel's explanation for this was that he was injured when he fell from a trapeze during gymnastics. He was also examined by several more doctors at this time to try and verify if he was really deaf and mute. Their findings were pretty inconsistent. A doctor from the Prague Institute for the Deaf and Dumb in Prague Smiehoff examined Karel and concluded that the named person is not only extremely intelligent, but also unusually educated, which does not correspond to his claim that he's not spoken since he was young and that he is deaf. The doctor believed that his level of articulation in two languages was not possible for someone who was born deaf and only began learning relatively recently. He also felt that Karel's communication through gestures was not very advanced, suggesting that he likely began to do so later in life as opposed to doing so in his childhood. However, the doctors were puzzled because they would do things like randomly slam loud objects near Karel, and he would never flinch. If he was faking it, he was doing a very convincing job. Karel was detained in Prague for a total of about 6 months. He was allegedly a victim of extreme interrogation tactics here, including torture. In one agency report from October of 1955, an agent described his behavior by saying, "He said he didn't care. They do what they want. He doesn't mind as long as he says he can stand it. Well, if he doesn't, we'll see. He would also like to meet with the investigators when he bursts, and with all the doctors too, and indicate how he would beat him with the edge of his hand. And the longer they allegedly abuse him, the worse for them. The percentage of guilt will increase." In a report from November of that same year, the agent said, "In the evening, when Novak returned from the afternoon interrogation, he no longer wrote anything at all, and only when asked if it was so bad that he was devastated, he nodded. When he returned to the cell and the guard closed the door behind him, he leaned against the corner of the door and held his head, showing that his head and stomach ached terribly. Then he sat down and threatened to clench his fist up, but he didn't write anything at all. He then walked, almost into the evening, around the cell with his head down, still twisting it from side to side." Despite this, Karel Novak never changed his story. At one point, while being questioned by a guard, he said, "In the first case, there would be a man who sold out and works for the enemy. In that case, the man would be normal. In the second case, there's an innocent man, but then the man is not normal. In any way, there's no way out for him." In December of 1955, he was released from custody due to a lack of evidence. He was given a winter coat, a hat, boots, and socks, as well as 100 Czech korunas. He began to look for work. He eventually got a job as a worker in a concrete group. He seemed to enjoy this job, and he even befriended one of his co-workers, a man named František Vase. The two became close friends, and Karel was often invited over to socialize with František's family, including his wife and parents. However, not only was Karel still being monitored by state security, he was also required to provide a daily report to the Kladno department of the UK because he didn't have any identifying documents. Karel was frustrated by this, and he sought to obtain the proper documents to be granted Czechoslovakian citizenship so he could live a normal life and marry his girlfriend. He petitioned the local national committee in Kladno in 1956 by saying that he wanted to live as a human being. He still couldn't provide any identifying information, but he did end up receiving a temporary identity card and eventually citizenship. But things went downhill for Karel in August of 1956. On the 20th of August, Karel's friend František made his way to the District Department of the Ministry of the Interior in Kladno and stated that he had a serious offense to report. František said that he initially befriended Karel because he could tell that he was intelligent and was educated in a variety of fields, such as history and politics. The two eventually became very close, and František started to believe that his friend wasn't telling the truth about being unable to speak or hear. František claimed that earlier in the month, Karel verbally confessed that he wasn't actually deaf and he was so tired of pretending that he couldn't hear. František also said that Karel could speak more languages than he'd previously claimed. Apparently, he was fluent in Czech, Slovak, English, German, and Polish, as well as knowing some French and Italian. He also said that he was actually older than he was pretending to be. Another allegation made by František was that Karel had told him an entirely different story of why he was in this situation. Apparently, Karel claimed that he was the son of an Austrian prince. He was being raised on a Polish farm when he and the staff were taken to Russia. A few years later, he tried to return to Poland and ended up being tried and convicted. Once he was released from custody, he worked as a servant for a few years before being recruited to the Polish army. While he climbed up the ranks quickly, his real identity was eventually found out, and that's when he tried to flee to Czechoslovakia and got arrested by the guards in 1955. The story is certainly interesting, but it was never verified. František went on to become an agent for the military in 1958, and he worked mainly in a section that was devoted to finding out the identity of Karel Novak. He held this position for about 10 years. Surprisingly enough, the two remained friends for the remainder of Karel's life. Pretty soon after František made these allegations, Karel actually began to speak in public. In September of 1956, he spoke in front of the Ministry of the Interior in Kladno and explained that he suddenly found himself able to speak and hear after waking up from a car crash. He said, "In the summer of 1956, sometime before the air show in Prague, I suffered an accident while driving a truck that crashed. When I woke up unconscious in the hospital, it was somewhere in Inner Prague, I began to realize that I could hear and that I was able to make more inarticulate sounds through my mouth. His accent when he talked was described as being Polish, Russian, or East Slovak." In addition to this, Karel was very educated on Marxism and he was a vocal supporter of communism. He joined the Communist Party in 1957 and he also served in the army. During his service, he was viewed as being exceptionally skilled. He excelled in understanding orders and regulations, leading newcomers, and shooting accurately. However, these talents ended up working against him because they attracted the suspicion of military counterintelligence specialists. They observed Karel taking photos of military-related buildings and tanks. Despite the fact that there was no evidence of him engaging in espionage while he was being surveilled, officials remained convinced that he was hiding something. They continued to show his photo around and monitor his phone calls and correspondences. Eventually, in 1961, he was arrested once again. This time it was for charges of conspiracy and espionage, and he was jailed. Instead of continuing to say that his name was Karel Novak, he started to claim that he didn't know his name or who he was. He was interrogated and injected with amphetamine, which was believed to be a truth serum that would cause people to be unable to maintain their lies. He continued to deny all the allegations of him being a spy, as well as any of the witness testimonies that authorities had collected over the years, such as the people who claimed that they saw him in refugee camps. His story about how he gained the ability to hear and speak was different than before. Now he said, "In 1956, I went to Prague, where I wanted to visit the Institute of the Deaf and Dumb. I arrived by car and by bus in Prague, where I took a taxi that crashed. I must have lost consciousness because I only woke up in a hospital, where I found that I could hear and speak at the same time. I don't know where the particular car accident happened, how it happened, or where and in which hospital I was lying, because I don't remember anything." Karel was examined by anthropologists who estimated his age as being between 27 and 35 years old at the time. Psychologists studying him at this time stated that he was above average intelligence and showed signs of psychopathy, but denied that he was mentally ill or had amnesia. Around this time, yet another person claimed to recognize Karel. A Polish woman named Teofila Grabowska said that he was her son Florian, who'd been arrested by Nazis and sent to Auschwitz, where he was assumed dead. However, she believed that he was alive when she saw photos of Karel. When she met him in person, she completely changed her tune and said that he actually looked nothing like her son. Karel also maintained that he had no idea who she was. Some people have theorized that he was actually her son and she was lying because she was worried that he might be in danger if she identified him. Currently, Karel was sentenced to 12 years of prison in a center that was designed to detain political prisoners. Agents pretending to be inmates spied on him during his sentence, and they said that he mostly kept to himself, was highly intelligent, and seemed distrusting and quiet around others. These agents also said that he was strongly against anti-Semitism, which led to the speculation that he himself may have been Jewish. This is unconfirmed, and he generally seemed indifferent to religion. The authorities were still desperately trying to find someone who could identify Karel, and more possible leads started to pop up around this time. A soldier named Vladimir Hintnau said that he recognized Karel in a photo because he'd seen him at the Wells camp in Austria around 1954. A second lead came from a refugee referred to as Leo Parma, who said that he was supposed to meet with Karel in Germany in 1951 so that they could travel to Austria together. However, they were detained by the police. Leo Parma believed that Karel had actually emigrated to Australia. A third person who recognized him was another man named Karel. In 1953, he was serving a 16-year sentence at a camp in Czechia and said that he saw Karel Novak there. This witness claimed that Karel's real name was either Vatruba or Veimola. Karel ended up being released early for good behavior in 1969, but this doesn't mean that he was done being spied on and monitored by the authorities. In an effort to find out his true identity, they had both a documentary and movie made about him. The movie's called The Case of the Dead Man. Spoiler alert, the movie actually ends with a character that was based on Novak being called as a spy and killed. Also, just before the documentary was released, a man came forward saying that he recognized Karel as being someone named Stefan who he met in 1947. He claimed that Stefan was a deserter from the Ukrainian Union of Nationalists, and a man named Oldrich Havlicek was supposed to help him fly across the border into Czechoslovakia. This information was never confirmed, but when the documentary was released and the information was made public, Oldrich attempted suicide. He later claimed that it was solely due to disagreements with his wife, but it's pretty strange timing. In the next few years, Karel started to befriend people who were considered to be working against the regime and conspiring against the then-president Gustav Husak. In 1979, he was questioned by the authorities and his apartment was raided. They found a number of prohibited books there, and this justified them continuing to spy on him. 2 years later, in early November, they arranged to have Karel questioned yet again. However, this never ended up happening because Karel Novak died on November 18th of 1981 while with his friends. An autopsy determined that his cause of death was a heart attack. The police ended up searching his apartment after his passing, and the report stated that the place looked like someone else had already inspected and perhaps cleaned it up. There were no suspicious belongings other than some of his things being coated in an unknown chemical, as well as him owning a radio transmitter that had the capability of transmitting foreign signals. After his passing, the case remained unconcluded. Authorities tried to pick it back up again in the 1990s, but they found no further information on Karel's true identity. Overall, he was investigated for almost 3 decades. There are quite a few theories as to who Karel Novak really was. Many claim that he was a secret agent based on his inconsistent story, the witness testimony, and his incredible abilities like his fluency in multiple languages. Others believe that he was actually a victim of war and claim that the scars on his forearm are due to him possibly trying to hide the tattoo he was branded with. It's also possible that he was perhaps mentally ill, or even that it was a total coincidence or bizarre circumstances. There's also apparently some rumors surrounding him that claim he had some sort of supernatural powers. According to one article, some people believe that he could read minds, change his eye color at will, and that he was clairvoyant. None of these claims have any evidence at all behind them, so I decided to save them for the end and just mention them quickly. What do you guys think about Karel's identity? Let me know in the comment section below. This topic doesn't really have a lot of English coverage, and I relied a lot on Google Translate and YouTube subtitles to get the info. The Reddit poster Mouflon Lesney also did a great write-up on Karel Novak, and that was really helpful here. I just wanted to end the video by giving a quick update to you guys. As part of my university program, I'm required to complete 2 unpaid internships. My first one has started, and it's full-time with about a 2-hour daily commute for me. Since it's unpaid, I'm also looking for part-time work on my days off or after my shifts. I'm trying my best to keep up with the upload schedule, but I hope you guys can understand if I need some extra time to finish the videos. I just wanted you guys to know why it seems like I don't check my notifications as much, or why my uploads may slow down for a few months. Thank you all for watching my videos, and I hope I'll see you in the next one.